Welcome everybody to a program with artist Martin Blank, who you see on the screen along with Tom Hawk of Hawk Galleries. And I'm David Stark, the chief curator of the Columbus Museum of Art, delighted to host Martin and Tom in a program that will run for approximately 1 hour, where Martin will be talking about his art, he'll be showing some videos, and we're also eager to answer questions that you may have. And just in terms of a little housekeeping, wanted to indicate that if you move your mouse or if you have a mobile device, if you touch your screen around the edges, you'll see an icon with the letters Q&A and two little cartoon bubbles. If you have questions to address to Martin, you can type them into Q&A and we can answer them either during or towards the end of this program. And if you are experiencing technical difficulties, if, for example, the picture isn't, or the images aren't showing up very well on your screen, or you can't hear very well, if you click the word chat that has another balloon-like icon over it, you can enter your question under chat, and we have some technical support live that can assist you in that case. So what I'd like to do now is turn the program over to Martin and Tom, and I am going to be listening in the background and joining you towards the end of the hour. Take it away, Martin and Tom.
Well, great. I think next step is my role. And thank you, David. I would like to thank Nanette Macy-Junes, Executive Director of the Museum, Chief Curator David Stark, as you just saw, and their professional team of associates, including Nicholas in the background, who have helped produce this discussion today. Through Nanette's leadership, the museum has championed contemporary glass over the years and is an appreciative partner of Hawk Galleries. The titans of contemporary glass have not only spoken in the museum auditorium, but a number of them have actually mounted impressive solo exhibitions there too, including Chihuly, Lino, Twice, Christopher Reese, and next year, Dan Daly. The wonderful public response to these exhibitions encouraged and enabled the museum to acquire important works from these artists and others too, including dear friends of both mine and Martin's, Columbus residents, Bob and Rachel Stern, who have generously donated Martin's stunning Convergence, which you see over my shoulder, to the museum's permanent collection, which is presently on exhibit and was the impetus of today's talk. So thank you, Bob and Rachel, very much. Perhaps after Martin's remarks, Chief Curator David Stark might mention the museum's exciting future plans for contemporary glass in the Walter Wing. A new book on Dale Chihuly is presently being written by art historian Henry Adams, who has studied leaders of Chihuly's glassblowing teams known as gaffers. Martin Blank headed up Chihuly's team for 12 years, which includes many late night calls from Chihuly, an artist who Martin actually dreamt years ago was trying to kill him. I digress. The reason I brought up this book is that the respected author made a keen and significant observation that while many of Chihuly's handful of highly skilled gaffers over the years, like Benjamin Moore, William Morris, Rich Royal and Jim Mongrain, brought tremendous technical skills to the hot shop, Martin brought not only that, but also something unique and special too. And I quote from the book, "Exuberant, manic, both charming and disarming, Martin loves the wild and unpredictable. And in that way, of all Dale's glassblowers, seemed to think in a way most similar to Dale himself, with his love of the asymmetrical and off-center." Artist Judy Pfaff continued saying, "You know who I worked with too, who I actually quite loved, is Martin Blank, who is crazy, wacky, and he blows hot and loose, which is my kind of blowing." Like most of Dale's lead gaffers, he's a big, powerful guy, but as you watch him, what's surprising is the grace and delicacy of his moves. Martin identifies with the glass, actually becomes the glass, and loses himself in its fluidity and unruliness. He's not even thinking, he is the glass. It's surely no accident that Martin played a major role working closely with Dale in creating a string of inventive new forms, particularly the Persians. Martin's antic personality infuses the series, Dale comments. He was very creative, very energetic, and interested in experimental things, working on the edge. All the things I like in a glass blower. Nell, that's the end of the book, but some great comments there and observations. Chihuly witnessed this in Martin very early on, and so did gallerists and collectors who have supported his professional development and career. It has been my privilege to represent Martin for 25 years. I also trust his heartfelt intuition and sensitivity to explore the numerous concepts behind his work. As a gallerist, I trust him empirically to consistently mount killer exhibitions. More importantly, he's a close friend. We talk frequently, not only about business, but also about the joys and challenges of life and about our art world. I trust his opinion on those things. His huge heart overflows with a contagious love of life, which guides and directs his creative hands to both draw on paper and to sculpt molten glass. These are the few of the many reasons why I believe Martin to be perhaps the singular artist who is leading the next generation of masters of contemporary glass. In fact, I like to refer to him as Martinangelo. And I'm not alone in my position. Museum directors and curators agree. In the past year, several museums have added major architectural installations to their permanent collections, which Martin will address in some great videos coming up. Please help me give Martin a warm welcome from Ohio's capital city. Martin, it's all yours, buddy. Io.
Right, unmute. Let me start that again. Good morning, and I'm so excited to be here. Let me start out with an OH to my friends out there.
Io.
All right. Well, thank you for that introduction, Tom. And it's just it's a miracle. It's just always magic to get to be together and have an opportunity to talk about art and to share with you. And I want to thank all my friends at the museum and this unique relationship between the artists, the collectors, the gallery, and the museums. Without this extremely mutualistic relationship, none of it would be happening. We all depend on each other and support each other. It's been a journey. I love this opportunity for you and I to have a discussion and share some of the things we've done over the years. As you had mentioned, last year was an extraordinary museum. An extraordinary year as far as collections in museums and acquisitions. One piece I want to share with you, it just sort of starts the whole picture rolling and gets a feel for the creative process and the challenges that one embarks on when you work at an architectural level. This video I'm going to share with you right now is a sculpture that I did for Mike Kurzman at the Lurie Company in Chicago, and I was contacted by him. And he's like, what would you do in this lobby? And it started out and it began to grow and unfold. And there's so many stories behind that particular exploration. But without Mike and all the other wonderful people involved in that, it would never have happened. The piece ended up, and now this piece sits in the lobby of the Fort Wayne Museum of Art. And Charles and Amanda Shepherd are the curators and chief of the museum, and their amazing staff helped me and my team go there and do the installation. So I think you'll enjoy this. You'll get a little sense of who I am, how I'm thinking, and there's some backstory we'll share after we watch this video. So Nick, if you'd go ahead and run that video, we'll go from here.
We put an iconic stamp of Repose and Honor by Martin Blank in your institution. This will become what we're known for. A work like Repose and Honor is an addition to the collection that we could never have hoped for and now have achieved. This particular gallery room needed a certain kind of piece to be what it really was meant to be, and Repose in Amber is that piece.
When I was young, I was an absolute pyromaniac, and I loved origami. I also used to blow giant smoke bubbles and make inflatable rooms that you could wander through. I'm a very kinetic person. I'm that kid with ADHD.
Okay, so, as I was saying, this is really uncomfortable.
I vibrate. You know, I get, that's what I call enthusiasm and excitement. I'm vibrating and this is awesome. And when I'm sculpting, I'm like, yes, there's just a spontaneity and a joy to putting components together. And I step back and it's like, it's resonating. And it's that tree, it's that landscape, it's the cliff that I stood on. Also, childlike wonderment. You know, when you're a child, you're uninhibited and you're spontaneous.
Martin himself is in the top 8 of the most important artists of the 21st century. So this is historic in the sense that this is a strong commitment on behalf of this institution to celebrating the best of American sculpture.
To make great work, you have to be willing to lose everything all the time. You have to be comfortable with failing. And the people, you know, oh, you're an artist, you must have so much fun. And I'm like, fun? Are you like sometimes I'm on the floor crying. You know, it's ugly, it's horrible. What have I done? I've just spent $10,000 and I have, you know, this is terrible. That usually fades away a little bit later. I get my act back together again and I start over.
It's a bolder, braver thing to do what Martin
did. The audio went out.
And get his things around him and start going, yeah, that works. Oh, but I don't now like the space that makes over here. So let's do this so that space works and the solid works. And to not, I mean, honestly, you don't know exactly what's going to happen. This piece, Repose in Amber, is such a great piece of proof that Martin's approach works. Time and time again, he gets us to where we need to go, and it's a beautiful place to be.
The goal was to create individual islands, but that as you walk in, everything foreshortens, and you just see what, abstractly speaking, that this one would represent a head, this would be the big torso, and then the nice round hips, and the long, elongated calf section, and then down at the end are the toes. You know, when you're in bed, your toes are just wiggling. All you see is your toes wiggling at the end of the, in the sheets at the end, and you're always so cozy, and I'm like, oh, I just love climbing into bed. And so that was the wiggling, happy toes just down at the far end. Some may see it, some may not, but it was pulled out and stretched out so that from certain vantage points, you could see the totality of this expression. And that was the goal of the piece. And I think we did it. This is called three-dimensional light. There's a volume in here forever when the lights are on where this frequency of rose light or amber light is always going to be projected and collecting in here because the frequency of the light is getting changed as it passes through the color. And it's always going to give you this, I mean, that's magic. This is, we call it a stone grind. I intentionally pitted the surface so that you would look at the surface. Here, I've left it open and untouched from the furnace heat so that you can look in and see the veiling and experience another layer of color, another pattern.
You spend some time with just this one sculpture and I don't think you go away the same person. Your heart and your imagination are gonna get played with somehow. You know, you go home and after the meal, instead of sitting in front of the tube, you went downstairs in the basement and you started building a strange radio. Or a set of, you know, bionic devices, and you think, why am I doing this? And I didn't even do it right. I'll do it better tomorrow night.
You know, for me, great art should be like an incredible piece of music, you know, where the waves, they resonate, and that particular tone hits you, and you hear what that artist was trying to communicate. And I'm trying to communicate a wonderment and an enthusiasm and a reflection back on the natural world. You know, and we think of our lives as concrete, but they're just this little 80-year-old blip. You know, then it's over. So I want to do something with this life, and I want to make an object that when you walk up to it, you feel it.
That's great, Martin.
Thank you.
Can I ask you a question?
Please.
How does an artist who walks into a building lobby, take us through the creative process of how you experience the space, how you get inspired, how color, you know, might interject in this, because not everybody can walk into a space and envision something that spectacular.
Yeah, Yeah, well, thanks. It's a process. It doesn't just happen. You have a group of people that bring you, you're in the space, you fly to the site first, and then it just takes time, Tom. You know, it really is about sitting back. I like to drink tea. I've got my teacup right here, and I often will just sit there and watch the steam and realize how ephemeral it is and how it's just, its molecules are just changing. I can't see them, but the steam and the water is still there. And so it's about sort of thinking. And you look at a space and you get a feel for the space, and you have to spend time quietly ruminating and just giving yourself a break. I see the world in pictures. I'm dyslexic and everything shows up in my brain in a picture, Tom. You get some feedback from the Mike Kurzman and his team about what they want the lobby to represent. And so I just start. You start and you make decisions and you make models and you sketch. And I'll go from just a squiggle to a 10-foot mock-up. Like, I'm not one of these artists that needs to render a giant space to, or render a perfect rendering and then you build the render. Glass blowing is very spontaneous, and working in hot glass, as you can see in the video, takes a team, and a lot of mistakes happen. So you constantly are exploring, creating, observing, and then critiquing and putting forms together. And I got the idea. And I then, of this repose in amber, these five islands of sculpture that would work on their own as independent sculpture, but from a certain vantage point, they line up and foreshorten. And abstractly speaking, in a Moore-esque way or an arc way, you'd see these forms line up and become an abstract silhouette of a form, of a repose. It's really, the commonality amongst artists is that it's a journey. You know, we're always looking, we're always exploring. And it's not the final product, it's the exploration.
At some point you have to say it's done, right? how do you know when it's done? You know when to start and how to get to a certain point, but are you kind of constantly fidgeting with things and rearranging and, but then yeah. There comes a point where, is it the delivery date? Is that when it's done?
pretty, Tom, that's brilliant. It's pretty true. There are many types of artists. I'm the one who's pushing myself, my team and my boundaries. And I want to maximize on it. So I'm constantly, you know, when you take forms and you put them together, whether they're like this or whether like this, or if they're like this, it changes the whole feeling of the sculpture. So I'm constantly turning and turning and turning. And at a certain point, you just have to say, you're done. I'll explore that idea on the next piece. I'll explore that on, I'll try that on the next. And that's where my inspiration comes from. Everyone asks frequently, where does inspiration come from? Well, it comes from doing. I make pieces. I love the relationships of bringing form. It's almost theater where you're bringing forms together and suddenly there's this energy that happens with just air, this negative space, this attention that develops. Hey, Tom, I put together a video that I thought I'd share with you and everyone watching. I don't know. It just sort of seems with our time frame that I should share it. And it's an explorer. It really is something. It's my life, you guys. I'm going to share my life with you. it's been an amazing journey. There's a lot to say. There's a lot of varieties of forms of art. There's so much that's gone into making art. I think that this video is going to really give you and the audience and the folks at the museum a sense of who I am, what I think about, and then we can continue the dialogue after that.
Great.
I'm going crazy, but everything you said amazed me. Seems too easy on the ear to be something I should adhere to. You told me to just simply wonder rather than take shelter under and open my heart to the thought that life is something you're not caught at. Too easy to get lost in progress. I didn't see you there in thy dress. And suddenly the world seems so small. We fit it all inside our front hall. Edison would spin in his grave to ever see the light that you gave. Don't wanna take it nice and slow here. Don't wanna waste a minute more, dear. The universe just vanished out of sight. And all the stars collapsed behind a pitch black night. I can barely see your face in front of mine. But it is knowing you are there that makes me fine. Maybe it's the warmer climate. Maybe I'm a smarter primate. Maybe it's the beer I'm drinking. Maybe I've stopped overthinking. Baby, you're the words and chapters, the sweetness in the morning after. You are the cry that turns to laughter. You're the hope that ends disaster. The universe just vanished out of sight. And all the stars collapsed behind a pitch black night. And I can barely see your face in front of mine. But it is knowing you are there that makes me fine. But the universe is just an empty space. And all the stars can disappear.
All the colors are crackling, the leaves are alive. With a note from your heart I keep written inside. Frozen air surrounds your eyes. As you speak, fountains collide. With a mouthful of stars I trip under my feet. You've blown me away. I can hardly speak. Stolen my silence. Scattered my peace. I'm lost in the dark. Mislaid my spark. Stars, I trip over my feet. You
Pretty impressive again, Martin. Let me ask you, my first impression is the scale that you work on is incredible. What is it like to have hundreds of pounds of molten glass on the end of a blow rod as you pursue a grand vision? I mean, that's unbelievable.
Yeah, you know, Tom, I've always, I never let the parameters of the materials sort of limit what the expression is. I'm a bit of a, my dad's an inventor and I've always been a bit of an inventor. And glass blowing physically, you know, to start getting a piece this big, beyond that, it's very difficult. So I started building equipment so that I could manage the weight. I think one of the most important things that has to happen when you are working at that scale is you have an amazing team of workers that have worked with you for a long time. Like John Harvey's been with me for over 10 years and he's sort of the main guy on the end of a wheel. John, Tom, I put a wheel on the end of a blowpipe. That was a big deal. That gave me mechanical advantage so that you could begin to work masses that just weren't held handheld. And you have Brandon Callahan and Nicole Keperon and just a whole slew of just wonderful people that jump in every week with me when I'm in the hot shop. Sometimes, Tom, it's terrifying. Sometimes, as you saw in the video, I give it my absolute all. And I want, and there's a certain point where you just have to give up because it's not going your way. You know, you're just kind of beating your head on the wall because it's like pushing on a rock. You know, everyone thinks it's for a moment it's fluid, for a moment it's graceful, but then within seconds it hardens and it's like a rock and you're trying to push on it. So it's a very emotional experience, Tom. It's not this, it's sort of on everything. It's ecstatic. It's terrifying, and then it's really engaging and satisfying.
But you're wearing multiple hats simultaneously as you're trying to experience this freedom in the studio to like let the glass speak to you and you speak to it. But at the same time, there's a budget that you're dealing with. In the case with some of these huge projects, this is uncharted territory. It's not I think this is going to cost about this. I mean, how do you navigate that? How do you navigate a budget and then just trying to work within that budget on a piece that could literally take you 2 years to make?
Yeah, so Tom, I've screwed up a lot of times. it comes from trial and error, buddy. As you know, you've been involved in a couple of them. If you walk away from an architectural project with a few shekels in your pocket, you've done all right. You really, from experience, you know, you do write a business plan. You mentioned multiple hats. A lot of people don't realize that being, you know, there's the artist hat and then there's the creative hat, but then you have to have the, the accountant hat and the engineering hat. You life's a crapshoot, buddy, right? And making art and making a big architectural piece is really just, you make plans and you try to stay on budget. At a certain point, this is where the problem between the artist and the businessman dilemma occurs. I've run out of money. Luckily, I've learned that you can go back and renegotiate a budget. You can ask for more help. I was on the Museum of Glass. That's a 207-foot reflecting pool. When you see it, you're in the glory, you're in the furnace working and you've maxed out the glory hole and you have this mass of people and you've got all your protective gear and everyone's jumping in and out with paddles trying to protect you. And you make this thing and there's this high five and this intense energy. You put that in the box and it comes out and you put it in your studio and it's 15 feet tall in the air and you're looking at it and you're feeling just really jazzed. You feel like you've got it. I understand this piece. It's got a vision. And then you cart it out and you put it in the reflecting pool and it looks like a little piece of popcorn floating on the wall. So what's your perception? What's your reality? It keeps shifting. It keeps changing and you have to be nimble. You have to be willing to be afraid. You have to be willing to fail. You know, I was reading over and over on Andy Goldsworthy. We many artists share the same thing. Ian Pei last night was talking about you have to, success is measured by your failures. You look at Goldsworthy's work, it's constantly, he makes it and then it falls apart and it's gone, right? So sure, my work, like, go ahead.
You're a risk taker. I mean,
absolutely. I am a risk taker. I love to scuba dive in a hot air balloon and blow glass with 200 pounds on the pipe. And trust, I'm also very trusting that people are going to jump in there and help me and protect me and make sure that we're going to be able to get to this vision. It's complicated. You know, it's not, it's there's no one answer, Tom. You know, it really is a, you know, I think it speaks to the relationship of the collector, the patrons who support the incredible institutions at the museum. And then the museum people, the gallery people like yourselves, and the relationship that you and I have as confidants and bouncing back and forth. I want to share one quick story. I was 2/3 of the way done with the Museum of Glass, and I had run out of money. And I wanted to back end with all the WISPs, a certain scale. And I called up, Ferd Hampson was helping me at the time. And I said, Ferd, I don't know what to do. I don't have enough money to buy all the stainless to make sure I can get all these components in there. And I don't want to be in debt after making this project. And he looked at me, we spoke, and he said, Martin, you haven't gotten here by not taking risks. That's who you are. And I guarantee if you don't make that piece the way you want it to be right now, today, you will regret this 10 years from now. And I ponied up and I changed the budget and I found the money and I ordered all of that, you know, like another 20 grand worth of stainless steel to make sure that it had the expression. And I went into debt, but I learned that I could ask for more help, and and other people came to my help because they believe in the creative spirit. They believe in humanity and our personal growth and exploration and the importance of art by moving people, inspiring people, living an inspired life.
But that starts with you as the artist, you know, and everybody else just tries to support your vision and your passion. And, you know, I think it's just been interesting to come out and see work in your studio.
Yeah.
And then it's a completely different feel in a gallery situation. I'm thinking of like Convergence.
Yeah.
And then it goes to Bob and Rachel's home, and the way it changed with the changing seasons and light, it was like constantly changing within their home. And then they moved homes and it changed more. And now it has a whole different feel at the Columbus Museum of Art. So it's, you know, as the venue changes, the piece sort of, it's amazing. It's resolved enough that it holds its own in so many different places, which I think is interesting.
Well, sort of the, I mean, for me, it's like one of the miracles of this material that we've chosen to explore. I mean, look at the photo behind you. That's Convergence at sunset. It looks completely, you know, and the sunrise, and you know, it's literally just capturing light. It's capturing photons, and they're bouncing through, and they're reflecting back out, and it's emanating light, and it's almost my work and a lot of outdoor installations. One of the things I'm thinking is it's sort of an anti-Turrell room, you know, where in a James Turrell room, you're looking up passively, relaxing and watching the sky. When you're standing in front of Convergence at the museum or Fluent Steps at the Museum of Glass in Tacoma, you're observing form and the complex relationship of forms and the cadence and patterns that I've developed. But one unique, and what's unique to this material, is that it's not just reflecting light, it's actually emanating a different frequency of light back at you, and it's capturing that light. So as we might be having a conversation next to the piece, and in Seattle we have a lot of gray sky days, and the piece tends to be kind of gray, and suddenly the light comes out, and it's really I hope you get to experience this, Tom, is that suddenly the piece has energy. And the whole piece just lights up like a stage set, like suddenly the lights get turned on and 80 feet of glass sculpture in front of you just illuminate and start to bounce and glow. And you're just sort of taken aback. And now you're grounded back in reality, that it's constantly changing. The light just came on and you're aware of your surroundings and the power of the light. And you then can see and observe that sculpture in an absolute new and unique way.
In those surroundings, I think it reminds me, Martin, here this museum is in Tacoma, where Dale Chihuly grew up. This is the Museum of Glass. You have been granted this important opportunity to make a statement even before your hand hits the handle to walk into the building. What's it like to be that guy? I mean, you're the guy, you know, you beat out a lot of people for that opportunity. It's a tremendous, you know what I'm trying to say. It's, how do you process something like that?
It's pretty easy, Tom. I have a lot of insecurities and I never feel like I've quite done my job good enough. And I always wish I could go back and make changes. And it's lovely that it projects that, it projects a completeness and a welcoming statement. It is a true honor. And I took that to heart. I mean, there's one thing you know about me is that I never want to let anybody down. I don't, when I'm given an opportunity, it's very, very important to me. And every sculpture I make, every piece I make, every exhibition I have, it's extremely important to me. So I never let those things go to my head.
Do you ruminate on it later at all? I mean, does it hit you sometimes as you walk up to the Museum of Glass?
Well, what's really cool is very special moment with that particular piece is there's a particular corner called Promontory Point that we named all the corners. Each piece had each area that we were working on had a particular name. A gentleman followed me up at the museum and he wanted to share with me. He wanted to shake my hand and I was like, "Hey, what's up?" And he just says, he's got his gal right next to him. And he says, "Hey, I just want you to know, I proposed to my wife right there on the corner." That's and cool. That gave me shivers, that they would find that spot sacred enough to make vows and make a commitment to their lives, and that they let me become a part of their life and help celebrate them. That speaks to what the creative, for me, that speaks to the responsibility and that my vision and what I'm seeking as an artist is working. And that I'm, Tom, often people, well, I often say making art is translating emotion into three-dimensional objects. So how do you get your passion and your experience and your vision into a static object and yet have it still resonate and speak to people? And when someone comes up to you and tells you like that I proposed to my wife in front of your sculpture, then you really can kind of go, wow. You feel content. Content's a word. I do love visiting the piece, walking up, and I do find faults in all the different areas. Part of it, there's a big part of it missing that needs to be remade. And I can't wait to get back into that and remake it.
Do you see sort of, you touched on a little bit, but, a sense of continuity, you make a lot of different series, but what would you feel would be sort of something that is a common thread throughout all these different explorations of form and concept behind your work?
Yeah, I'm a curious person, Tom. I like to look at things and I like to be out in nature and I like to be present, and that's very elusive. And I think when you're sculpting and making art, you have to wait for all the visitors in your head to leave you alone so that you can actually just sort of create. And
capture a moment, catch the moment.
Absolutely. And it's not even a moment because it's a progression. Like you said, a lot of these large architectural projects take two plus years to get your vision into reality, and you're dealing with architects and engineers. But when you go, going back to the continuity, there's a continuity. The first continuity is that I'm the artist that made them. There's multiple forms of art. There's multiple explorations and statements that you can make. I'm not, and like life and emotions, they're constantly changing. I focus on one arena for, or a form of sculpture for a specific arena, like a gallery exhibition. I create, it's like a theater experience, and then you actually go and set up the experience. And so there's continuity amongst the show and exploration amongst the show. Being the same artist that has the same curiosities. Those curiosities meld into my sketchbook when I'm drawing and just sort of penciling an idea. I'm always looking for spaces. I'm always looking for relationship between forms and dialogue. So there's that continuity where all my work is narrative, and it also is fluid, carving space. I'm always trying to get your eye to move to the other side of the page, whether it's a charcoal figurative drawing, whether it's a landscape. I'm always trying to bring your eye across the page, across the sculpture, and wrap around.
Was that something you learned from one of your mentors, maybe Adele Chihuly and Albert Paley? I mean, can you speak briefly about your experiences with, you know, I mean, they must have been completely different personalities, but maybe they had some similarities too.
Yeah, you know, Tom, it's hard to get your thoughts together and describe it all. I've always been like this, in the sense of I love to, like an architect, recreating space and reorganizing their space. There's something about making a sculpture that occupies space, and you're confronted with it, you have an emotional reaction, and then you walk around it, and now it feels different, and now it feels different from the other view. That's sort of an inherent part of my spirit, and I think you can see that through a lot of the pieces I've made. What is very exciting as an artist is being able to step in someone else's mind and work with them. And I sort of considered my experiences with my dear friend Dale, sort of my graduate studies, you know, being able to work with him and crawl. Luckily, we had a very distinct similarity in our creative vision, in the sense of our exploration. So you work, you create an object, and then you respond to it. And as it's happening in the moment, you press on it and it changes, and then you respond to it. So it's a very, it's very much like playing music. Working hot glass and working sculpture is very much like a dance. And the dance has different tempos. So the hot glass is one experience where it's very staccato. It hits you, you move, you're dancing with your partner. And there's moments where your partner's smiling at you. And then there's moments where you've stepped on your partner's foot, you know? So it has a life to itself. Then you have the life of the object and responding to that object. When I work with Albert, what was lovely is, you know, I have so much respect for Albert and his vision and his ability to create such monumental sculptures. I just sort of opened myself to his intuition, and it's lovely to crawl inside of others' heads. I mean, that's why I read. I just consume books. I actually listen to books. Yeah, if I weren't here and had my iPod and my earbuds in right now listening to a book, and it can be from Brian Greene's String Theory to some sort of Dune science fiction or The Shape of Water, or, you know, there's millions of books. And if you have anyone out in the audience has a great book that, an art book that they love or an artist that's written, I love to be inspired, and I love to get inside of others' perspective. I mean, I think it's why we're drawn to novels and why we're drawn to art is, how is this person thinking? What are they trying to say? And do I relate to that? Do I understand that? Do I have a similar sensibility? So one poignant moment with Albert is, I wanted to bring him into the theater of glassworking and let him actually put objects together,
Collaborating, is that right? He wanted to collaborate with you.
Yes, and it wasn't a true collaboration in the sense of where I made parts and he took my parts. It was a collaboration where I led him, I shared the window, I opened the window of the material, you know. It's a super cool liquid. It's a liquid. It takes the shape of its container or the tools pressing upon it. And I wanted for him to explore that because I knew he was very sensitive to the materials. And so as he's coming in with his gloves and he's all caught up in this moment, I'm watching, where is he going to place that piece? And in my mind, I was going to put it over here. And then I watched him put it over here, because I didn't see the totality of what his vision. I wish we had a little plug, you know, and I could plug into his brain and I could see exactly where it was going. But that adds to the surprise of, oh, wow, look at how he put it there. Oh, that makes sense with the total vision that I don't have access to in that moment.
That I mean, you could probably write a book on your experience with Albert, with Dale. I see our time, we're getting a little bit close to the hour. One thing I thought might be timely, because we're all experiencing this, how has COVID, what kind of impact has that made on you, on your many colleagues, you know, out in Seattle? You know, shows are being canceled. This should have been a live lecture, but I'm grateful we have it. But how is this impacting you as an artist, as an individual professional artist?
I think the whole world is in turmoil right now. And just let me speak directly to glass blowing. It is awful. The heat and the intensity and the teamwork that has to happen in order to create an object in the hot shop is very specific. And now it's changed. I've only blown a few times. I'm always a little scared. We all have masks on and face shields on, and we've got gobs of sanitizer everywhere. And it makes a very intense experience even more painful because you're wearing a mask. I can't breathe. I can't get any air in here. It's just like, it's already hard, Tom, you know, and I'm already, and it's hot. And I, you know, it's like life. It's a duality. I love it. I hate it. I love it. I hate it.
And so you miss it? I mean, the regularity of it, do you yearn to get back in there and just get up that class?
Oh yeah, Tom. Well, sometimes, you know, it's nice to actually step back and breathe. It's nice to step back and have a pause and not have the pressure of having to perform. And, you know, you're spending all of your money on this shot, you know, on this one day to make these objects, or multiple days. And so it's been nice. The world is in change right now, but it's sort of a microcosm for what's going on up in my own head, is that there's a duality going on. It is crazy, but yet I can relax and find happiness. I am scared. I have no idea what's going to happen in the future, but yet my dog and my wife and my family love me, and I feel contentment and I feel relaxed and at peace with them. You know, I'm so amazed with duality. Like this, you know, there's a lot of people that have written about the scale of life, this pendulum of life. You know, I often say to students, never ride on the laurels of your youth. You're young. You've got to grab this. You don't waste your life. It's going to go by so fast, you know, and I try to impart that little bit of wisdom. And then I turn around and say, don't be in a rush. Don't be in a rush, because it takes time. And life is this sort of sense of duality in every aspect which you're looking at. So COVID is, there's been a lot of beautiful moments. There's been a lot of joy. It is interesting. I always say to myself, whenever I get angry and frustrated and I'm cursing my life situation, I always remember to say, Martin, zip it. Because if you think it's bad right now, I know in 1 second, it could be 1,000 times worse.
You got to be thankful for the moment.
I'm very thankful. And I have a capacity. We all have a capacity to grow. We all have a capacity to change. And I think we're all learning that. Look, in the last few months, we're all learning to deal with the uncertainty. We all think that this is the limit, and then it notches up and it notches up. And then we all find that we have a capacity to grow and have strength to deal with adversity. And on top of all this, we still have the usual craziness that's going on in our lives and our heads. And so I think we're a very resilient species. I think we're a very interesting species. And learning more compassion and learning more tolerance and understanding and appreciating our distance, our distinctions, and it's a beautiful lesson that I think is going to happen, is happening from here.
That's well stated.
Thank you.
Maybe at this point, I think maybe perhaps David Stark might want to, have a few thoughts. Welcome, David.
David.
Yeah, well, I've really enjoyed listening and viewing the videos, listening to your comments. It's so enlightening and really inspiring. And I really like the what you just said about persevering through adversity, given the present crisis, or the many multiple crises that we're all facing, and you in particular as an artist. Bravo. There are a few questions that have been submitted. that I'd like to see how you might respond to. One says, with Convergence, that is the work that's in the Columbus Museum of Art, which is behind Tom's head, we never felt that, oh, and this is from Bob Stern, who generously donated the sculpture to the museum.
Thank you.
He writes, yes, with Convergence, we never felt that we had a sculpture. We had an infinite number of sculptures that changed virtually every second. And so that was more of an observation than a question, but it's something that you talked about a little bit already.
Yeah.
I don't know if you have anything more to say, but he has another question. Why don't I read that and then maybe you can talk about both of them together.
Sure.
When working with a piece in the hot shop, when do you start to envision the negative space into which it will fit?
So, thank you, Bob and Rachel, for being here. And it's so, there's a moment where a sculpture takes on a life of its own, and you're often surprised by how it represents itself in the world, in reality. You know, you're making, again, you're taking an emotional state, you're taking emotions and and you're creating and you're going through your creative process. And I have a unique vision, a very steadfast vision. But then suddenly the reality of light, the positioning, there are surprises that develop. And I think that's what makes the observation of art so exciting is that it is out in a changing world. And if you're willing to, you'll see the nuances of the change of that artwork. I had no idea when I made that piece, that Convergence, that it was going to be so spectacular. It has its own screen, its own theater behind it, the constant change of light throughout the day and time, which is such an interesting notion on its own, you know, time well, anyways, I won't go into that right now because we're running out of time, but light affects glass and witnessing the change of light throughout the day dramatically affects the piece. Speaking specifically to the forms, I'm an artist who is an intuitive sculptor. I respond to an object with a gut feel. So I have a palette of objects around my studio. You're looking at maybe a quarter of the elements that I created to put Convergence together, okay? I have a huge, so, and what I do is I just simply start. I have a vision and a feel. And I grab two elements and I look at them and I see how, where are they gonna go together? And I have a start point. And I also know that I have a certain scale that I'm going to create a grouping. And then it's a, and so you find the first two and how they relate to each other. And it's the two that are right behind Tom's head, the two where they're almost kissing, they're almost whispering to each other, but one's looking away. Why is he looking away? Are they talking? So it sort of starts a dialogue. And then I begin and I grab the tertiary component, the other main figurative component, and then fill in and fill in and fill in. And it's about walking around the piece, observing it, going home. And after 3 days, Tom, you asked me, when is it done? After 3 days or a week, if I can walk back into the studio, I go, oh, that's good. Oh, that's good. Oh, that's good. That's good. Usually I go, oh no, oh, got to change that. And a little turn suddenly changes, you know, dramatically changes the form. So Bob, it's an exploration and it's a process. And if you're from Canada, that's a process. And and it's a journey. It's not a linear defined moment. Does that explain that? I don't want to be repeating myself.
You create elements and then you play with those elements until it's a cohesive body. It's a result.
Yeah, like that red piece that's right behind you. That piece was in front of that object. That piece was behind that object. But I finally, that little hint of color, that makes that color so specific and so important. And I played with that form. It ended up between the first left-hand figure. It moves all over the place. And really what I do is I look at it and respond. And I look back to the layering and the whole emotional content of the piece and how it's going to, how it feels. Again, it really is. It's a feel. It's literally a visual piece of music. And great art, art is like music. All you should have to do is feel it. You know, you can come from any language. You know, you're looking at the look at, you know, you're looking at the Mona Lisa, you're feeling it. You're looking, you walk into the architecture of the Pantheon, you feel it. You look at a sculpture, you walk around, you feel it. And then when you get to walk around it, you know, painting, you reflect a story. A sculpture reflects a story, but then gives you opportunities to have different experiences or chapters in that story. How's that? Does that, that, that make sense, right?
Wow, let me write that down. David, as I know we're kind of drawing a little bit closer to our time limit, would you mind speaking? I know you had a few things to say, but amongst the many things you'd like to maybe touch on, or a few, could you speak to the future of contemporary glass and sort of the vision that the museum is working towards?
Yeah, absolutely. Before that, however, we did get one more comment, it, not a question, but a suggestion, a book that was suggested by one of the listeners, The Hair with Amber Eyes by DeWall. That's D-E-W-A-A-L. I don't know, Martin, from your expression, whether it's a book that you're familiar with, but it sounds as if that's something that was important to one of our viewers. And so we thank you for that. And yes.
Taking notes on that.
Uh-huh. And we indeed have some plans for contemporary glass to create a dedicated space for glass that's in the permanent collection. And we have so much contemporary glass that is so often kept in storage that we thought it was high time for an installation space, a dedicated place in the museum for glass lovers and all our visitors to be able to see highlights from the collection. And it will be located on the second floor of the Walter Wing. And stay tuned for more detailed information on when that will open and exactly where that space will be. And you can be assured that Convergence will be in that space, as well as a favorite work that's been on view for quite a number of months now, Sunflower by Michael Reese, a very large work that's in one of the galleries in our historic building, or the so-called Ross Wing, a very large glass, or a very large representation of a sunflower in glass that sits on a monumental pedestal that is a visitor favorite. So a lot more to come with glass in the Columbus Museum of Art. And unless Tom or Martin, you have any closing remarks or comments, I'd like to thank you sincerely for that really in stimulating and enlightening discussion about our piece by Martin and his process and his career and life and thoughts and feelings and his incredible creative talent in the works that he has created and continues to create. So we will continue to follow your career with great interest. And thanks to both of you for participating today.
Well, thank you, David, and all of your team and your staff. It's been an honor to share with you. And it is really a journey and a lifelong journey to amass and share all the visuals that I tried to share with you tonight. And it also speaks to the relationship with the artists and the gallery and the museum. I mean, I've been working with Tom for 20 plus years. And the Martin who showed up with Tom with his first exhibition, who had a model and we're drawing live in the gallery, and his support to go ahead, make that happen, and to being a confidant to working on private collections and sculptures, and then bringing the Stearns and having the Stearns donate to your incredible institution. I mean, it's just an honor. Life is a journey, and it's grand. It really is grand. And I thank you all so much for including me in your collection and being a part of it. And to talk with you, David, and hear your thoughts, it means a lot to me.
Thank you so very much. You're very welcome. And we hope that we'll hear more from you after post-COVID.
Yes.
Love to hear you live and in person in the museum. And by the way, this is being recorded. So some of you may be listening to this in recorded form, but I'd like to thank everyone, including Robert and Rachel Stern, for listening to us live. And I think that we might, Nick, could we switch to, so we'll say goodbye to your live feed, Tom and Martin, and if we can get a screen that is mocked up that shows some of the things in the museum that people, that you, the visitors, can come in and enjoy. As you read what's on the screen, and I'll talk about that in just a minute, I want to call your attention to the fact that we have some upcoming programs. Again, if you're listening to the recorded version of this, some of these events may have already happened, but as of today, October 4th, Sunday, we have upcoming next week, November 11th at 2 o'clock, same time, same place, a program with the author of a book about the Renaissance master Raphael. Stephanie Story is her name, and she'll be speaking to us live about her new historical novel or historical biography, Raphael, Painter in Rome. And this relates to an exhibition of Renaissance tapestries that will be at the museum on loan from the Dresden Picture Gallery, the great museum in Dresden, Germany, that's coming to the museum in 2022. Tapestries designed from cartoons by Raphael. And coming up on our Wednesday at 2 program, where at 2 o'clock on Wednesday afternoons, we have speakers. Again, all of these programs are virtual. We'll have something coming up on November 18th, having to do with portraits of the ballet dancer Rudolf Nureyev, portraits by Jamie Wyeth on loan to us from the Brandywine Museum. And on December 19th, the Wednesday at 2 program will be dedicated to the major exhibition on the art of Amina Robinson that is opening in mid-November. And November 22nd, there will be a program at 2 o'clock that brings to us a speaker from Ohio State, the Ohio State University, Jody Patterson, a historian of American art, who will deliver the Keith and Nadine Pierce Lecture on American Art. That is an annual special lecture on American art. And the topic this year will be the art of Robert Gwathmey, a 20th century painter. So with that said, remember, as per the screen, we can accommodate visitors to the museum. Even if you don't have time tickets, come to the museum. You should be not really have a problem getting in. It's only Sundays that sometimes get a little crowded, but we'd love to see you. Join us for happy hours on Thursdays from 7 to 9 p.m. And as you see the date, Art After Stonewall, this exhibition that has been traveling with great success since it opened in 2019 in New York, then traveled to Miami. It is in its literally the final hours at the Columbus Museum. It closes at 5 o'clock today. So if you're listening to this live, come see Art After Stonewall, 1969 to 1989. I'm sure you will not be disappointed. And with that, I wish you a good afternoon, a good evening. Thanks again for listening to this program and for your interest and support of the Columbus Museum of Art. And I hope to see you again before not too long. Goodbye.